And welcome to Bromley Baptist Church. We'll be starting our service in just a minute's time, so do please come on in, grab those refreshments, take a seat, and we'll be beginning very shortly. Well, good morning, everybody, and welcome to Broadmead Baptist Church. A huge welcome to you this morning as we're coming in. Do grab a seat, finish having those hot drinks, and we'll begin our time together for our service this morning. A huge welcome if you're a member with us, if you've been here for a long time, and this is where you'd call home, or if you're visiting or joining us this first time this morning. We're really glad to have you with us as we have our time of worship together today. My name's Ellie, I'm a member of our church family here, and I'll be leading us through the first part of our service. Here at Broadmead Baptist Church, we are a family of people trusting in the good news of Jesus Christ. So everything we do this morning will be centered around who Jesus is. We'll be praying, we'll be singing, we'll be hearing from his word to us. And all of that is because we believe that Jesus is good news for us. And as a community, that is what brings us together, that spurs us on. We're a very different group of people from different countries, different backgrounds, but we are united in knowing and trusting in Jesus. Just one notice this morning to say for our kids groups, it's half term, so that means, you know, more people are away, and also some of our students are on a CU weekend away this weekend, so we'll be praying for them in that. But our kids groups will look slightly different, so there will be a creche for our younger children, but that will just be self-service, as we call it, so there won't be leaders. So if you do want to pop out and use that room, that's through the doors on the right there, but do please stay with your children. And then our Sparklers and Explorers will be joining together. So that's for anyone older than creche, basically. They're going to all go up to that room, but we'll remind you of that later. But that's just to bear in mind. We're reading the Bible in 2 years together at Broadmead, and we've currently been reading Acts over the past month or so. And later we'll be hearing John come and share the message of the book of Acts. So as we begin, I thought I'd just read from Acts 4, starting at verse 11. Jesus is the stone you builders rejected, which has become the cornerstone. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved. I'll just pray for us as we begin our time together. Lord Jesus, we praise you that you have saved us. We praise you that you are the cornerstone, the one who our lives are built upon. Father, we pray that you would just give us that longing to put our trust in Jesus alone and not rely on other things. Help us as we meet together today, Lord, help our ears to be ready to listen. Will you just give us joy that abounds from our hearts? Help us to sing praises and bring glory to you, Father. We pray this in your name. Amen. We're going to spend some time in song now, praising God, worshiping Jesus, who is the hope of the nation. So do please stand and we'll sing.
Jesus.
Praise you that you are the cornerstone, that we can be made strong in your love. We pray that we will long for that day where we stand before your throne, that we are one with you, that we are right before you because of your sacrifice for us, Lord. Yeah, help us to cling on to this, we pray. Amen. Do please take your seats, and I'm going to invite Lindsay up.
Okay. Hello. Good morning, everyone. Can I have all the boys and girls that are here? We might be down a few because it's half term, but if there's any kids want to come up to the front and have a seat just in front of me here on the wooden bit. So let's sit down off the stairs, everyone on the wooden bit. Oh, we're very small in number, but that might make it good. It might mean there's more chocolate for some of you later. Okay, so come on down. Okay, whilst you're coming down and getting sat down, I'm going to ask you a question. Could anyone tell me the best news they've ever heard? Or maybe some good news that you've had recently? You tell me some good news?
That it's going to snow.
It's going to snow? First I've heard. Is it going to snow soon? Yeah. Oh, I thought it was nice and sunny today. I have my sunglasses on. It's going to snow. Any other good news that we've heard? Jonah?
We'll get presents.
You'll get presents. Oh, I think we're getting in the Christmas spirit up here at the moment. So did anyone know what we got last night? Something happened to the clocks last night and it was some good news for me. Noah, what happened?
The clocks changed.
Yeah, did that mean, what did we get? An extra
hour?
We got an extra hour in bed. Did anyone find that good news? It was good news. I like that. Okay, so we've heard some good news this morning, but I have some extra good news and I've already hinted at it already. My good news for you guys is somewhere in this church, in this room, there is a box of chocolates and it's hidden, okay? And the good news is that if you can find it, then they will be opened at the end of the service. And if your mummies and daddies allow you, you will be allowed some chocolate, okay? So what I'm going to give you 1 minute to do, and this could be chaos, but all of you, is I'm going to give you 1 minute to try and find that box of chocolates, okay? But I'm looking at us, and there's maybe slightly less of us today, and it's a big church, so I'm actually going to ask for 2 volunteers, because I think it might be a little bit hard. So, Emmy, you can come up, and you can come up, okay? I'm going to tell these two where that box of chocolates is, okay? So you're going to be the only two that know, but your rule is you're not allowed to tell anyone. No matter how much they beg you, you're not allowed to tell them. Okay, so I want everyone else, you guys get up, maybe get some stretches going on because you're going to go and find the box of chocolates. So everyone up, ready to look, and I'm going to tell these two. So let's go over here. So no one hears us. Get stretched and you're ready to go. They're also not up here on the stage. Okay. Do we think, are they getting warmer or colder? Are they getting close?
Jonah, you're getting really close.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Getting so close. Interesting. You got 30 seconds and I'm going to ask you to come back here. Oh, they're so cool there. careful. Okay. We're going to do a 10 second countdown. These girls are going to help me. Okay, ready? We're going to do a 10 second countdown. 10,
9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Did anyone find them?
No.
Okay, come and sit down again now. So, not just yet. So, no one found them. That's a shame. We're not going to get any chocolate. How did it feel, Nina, that you couldn't find the chocolates?
Stressed.
Stressful. Very stressful. Okay. And does anyone want to tell me, how did it feel knowing that there were 2 people up here that knew exactly where they were and they didn't tell you? Does anyone want to say, how did that feel knowing that they knew and you didn't? Was that a good feeling? No, it was a good feeling. Okay, yeah, maybe we're like sad that they didn't tell us. Maybe I heard angry there. We'll not get too angry, but yeah, maybe it's sad that some people knew this good news and they didn't tell us. Okay, so what I'm going to do now is I'm going to allow them you can choose, decide between, you can choose one person, you can tell them where it is, and they're going to go. You can all go together and get the box of chocolates. Let's not fight over who. You can... Okay, go and tell one person. You can choose. Oh, that's okay. That sounds right. You tell. You're going to tell. Oh, sister or friend. Okay, just tell. You can tell both of them. Why don't you tell Thea and Nina where they are and you all go and get them? Okay, do we know? Do we find out where it is? Our very own minister was hiding the box of chocolates. Right, okay, let's come sit down. We'll not open them just yet, but I promise you we'll get some at the end. Well done. Okay, so just have a little seat for us. Okay, so that was some good news. We're really, really glad that we found the box of chocolates and their celebration, so even more good news. However, today in our service, John himself, who had the box of chocolates, is going to be talking to the adults all about some good news. And that is the good news that God loves us and that he sent his son Jesus to die for us, okay? And even better than having an extra arm bed, even better than having a box of chocolates, that is the best news that the world has ever heard or will ever know. And guys, there's lots of people in our world, just like you guys were running around the church looking for them, seeking some good news. There's lots of people in our world that don't know that news. But you guys are like the two that were up here who know that good news. You come to church, you come to Sunday school, you hear that good news week in, week out. And so, just like we said, it's sad when some people don't know the good news. And so, we should be the ones going to tell that good news. Okay, so that's what we're going to learn about in church today, that we can go out and we can give people that good news just like we got the chocolates. And that will just make lots of people really happy if they can find that. So I want you to think about that today. Maybe you think about over half term or when you go back to school, who could I share this good news with, what I learn in Sunday school with? And hopefully then we can give other people the hope and the joy that there is in finding that. So let's just give a round of applause to everyone that found the chocolates. And at the end, I will put them out by the tea and coffee. If your mummies and daddies allow, you can go and you can get yourself a little chocolate. But actually, I've just sent you back to your seats. I've just remembered, we're now going to sing about this good news. So if you want to come back up to the front or if you want to stay in your seats, that's okay. But we're going to invite the band back up who are going to sing about this good news. It's a song we've heard before, Good News Family. I think lots of you know it and know some actions. So if you want to come up and do the actions, so you teach the adults, you can come back up to the front. And I'm going to hand back over to the band.
Thanks so much, Lindsay. Yes, our next song has some actions which we would encourage you, whether you are young or old, to join in with. So we'll just run you through them quickly. It's very simple. There's only about four things you need to do. So we've got good news for you. Good news for me. We've got good news. It's Jesus. We're the good news family. That's all you've got to do. We'd encourage you very much to join in with that. And if any of our young people would like to come to the front and lead our church family in that, yes, Grace, love it. Then we would appreciate that because it can be easy to forget. So please stand and we're going to sing about being a good news family.
He paid for our sins, dying on the cross.
Great, do take your seats. Our children and young people are now going to go to their groups. So as we said, there's just a creche room available today, but that's going to be self-service. So do stay with your children if you'd like to take them to that. And then our sparklers and explorers are going to join together, and that's going to be in the room upstairs. And then our Connect group, 11 to 14s, are also going to head out for their activity. So while they're heading out, why not take a moment to introduce yourself to the person next to you and ask them what they've been up to this weekend. We'll invite you to draw those conversations to a close, but do please continue those after the service. We'll have plenty of time after we finish to carry on catching up and introducing ourselves to new people. I'm going to invite Solomon up now, who's going to come and lead us in a time of prayer as we speak and confess to the Lord, and then that will be followed by the Lord's Prayer as well.
Good morning, church family. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you that you have provided us a place to worship freely in this morning. Lord, we continue to pray for our hospitality month and the many events that have been happening across our church family. We ask that you continue to bless the time we have together, with one another, getting to know each other, and to allow for a forming of deeper connections. Lord, we pray that this would be a time of integration for our church family, especially for those who find it hard to meet new people. And we pray that those who struggle gain a new confidence in their hearts. Lord, we continue to lift up our home groups to you. Thank you that we are able to meet across Bristol as a smaller church during the week to refresh our minds and renew our spirits in your midst with one another. We pray for the home group leaders, the hosts, and the time spent here together. May you continue to provide us with the ability to share our weeks with one another in true fellowship and encouragement, so that we may glorify you, Lord, and help one another in our journey together through life. Lord, as Christmas is fast approaching, we pray for the planned events that are lined up within the life of the church. May we, as a church, feel the joy that it is to celebrate your life and the blessing that you are to us, just like that of the children of this church. Thank you that you came down, Lord, and left your throne room and glorious side and humbled yourself before us. We ask that you help us with your Holy Spirit, Lord, to spread that good news to the people of Bristol. Let us not forget how you've provided for many of us here today, and I pray that you stir our hearts to provide for those in need who may not have a family like we do here in this church. We ask, Lord, that you invite those particular people into this church this Christmas time to hear, to know, and to see your goodness and love for them. And finally, Lord, I take this moment to pray sincerely for those here today. Lead us in your truth. Prepare our hearts, O Lord. Soften our thoughts and minds this morning, our doubts, our unbelief. Show those today who don't know you, Jesus, that you are here in this church, right now, living and active, as we invite the Holy Spirit to fill each and every one of us. Let these words not fall on deaf ears, Father, especially as John humbly leads us in your word today. Reveal your glory and truth through the preaching of your word. Draw them near to you, Father, until every heart in this room confesses that Christ is Lord. For we proclaim this truth joyfully, embracing for the day of your glorious return, as those trumpets sound, to be reunited with you, Father, for eternity, forevermore. Amen. And the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Acts 3:19 says, "Repent then and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out, that times of refreshing may come from the Lord, and that he may send the Messiah who has been appointed for you, Jesus." It's wonderful news that when we confess our sin, when we bring it before the Lord, that we know that times of refreshing will come and that our sins will be wiped out. So let's just spend a moment doing that now. We'll have a moment of quiet just to bring things before the Lord that we'd like to repent of. And that all that means is just to say sorry, that we know that we have done wrong, but we want the Lord Jesus to transform that in our lives. So let's take a moment now. Lord, we praise you that we have the Messiah, Jesus, appointed for us to wash away our sin, to make us clean. We praise you that as we bring these things before you now, we know that we are righteous in your sight as you look upon your Son rather than us, Lord. And we thank you that this means we can draw near to you, that we can come with no guilt or no shame. We praise you that we can know that freedom, Lord. Amen. Our reading from God's word this morning is Acts chapter 28. It'll be on the Bibles around you as well as up on the screen behind me if you'd like to follow along. It's Acts 28, starting at verse 1. Once safely on shore, we found out that the island was called Malta. The islanders showed us an unusual kindness. They built a fire and welcomed us all because it was raining and cold. Paul gathered a pile of brushwood and, as he put it on the fire, a viper, driven out by the heat, fastened itself on his hand. When the islanders saw the snake hanging from his hand, they said to each other, "This man must be a murderer, for though he escaped from the sea, the goddess Justice has not allowed him to live." But Paul shook the snake off into the fire and suffered no ill effects. The people expected him to swell up or suddenly fall dead. But after waiting a long time and seeing nothing unusual happen to him, they changed their minds and said he was a god. There was an estate nearby that belonged to Publius, the chief official of the island. He welcomed us to his home and showed us generous hospitality for 3 days. His father was ill in bed, suffering from fever and dysentery. Paul went in to see him and after prayer placed his hands on him and healed him. When this had happened, the rest of those on the island who were ill came and were cured. They honored us in many ways, and when we were ready to sail, they furnished us with the supplies we needed. After 3 months, we put out to sea in a ship that had wintered in the island. It was an Alexandrian ship with the figurehead of the twin gods Castor and Pollux. We put in at Syracuse and stayed there 3 days. From there, we set sail and arrived at Rhegium. The next day, the south wind came up, and on the following day, we reached Puteoli. There we found some brothers and sisters who invited us to spend a week with them, and so we came to Rome. The brothers and sisters there had heard that we were coming, and they traveled as far as the Forum of Appius and the Three Taverns to meet us. At the sight of these people, Paul thanked God and was encouraged. When we got to Rome, Paul was allowed to live by himself with a soldier to guard him. 3 days later, he called together the local Jewish leaders. When they had assembled, Paul said to them, "My brothers, Although I have done nothing against our people or against the customs of our ancestors, I was arrested in Jerusalem and handed over to the Romans. They examined me and wanted to release me because I was not guilty of any crime deserving death. The Jews objected, so I was compelled to make an appeal to Caesar. I certainly did not intend to bring any charge against my own people. For this reason, I have asked to see you and talk with you. It is because of the hope of Israel that I am bound with this chain. They replied, "We have not received any letters from Judea concerning you, and none of our people who have come from there have reported or said anything bad about you. But we want to hear what your views are, for we know that people everywhere are talking against this sect." They arranged to meet Paul on a certain day and came in even larger numbers to the place where he was staying. He witnessed to them from morning till evening, explaining about the kingdom of God, and from the law of Moses and from the prophets, he tried to persuade them about Jesus. Some were convinced by what he said, but others would not believe. They disagreed amongst themselves and began to leave after Paul had made this final statement. "The Holy Spirit spoke the truth to your ancestors when he said through Isaiah the prophet, 'Go to this people and say, you will be ever hearing but never understanding. You will be ever seeing but never perceiving. For this people's heart has become calloused. They hardly hear with their ears and they have closed their eyes. Otherwise they might see with their eyes, hear with their ears, understand with their hearts, and turn, and I would heal them. Therefore, I want you to know that God's salvation has been sent to the Gentiles, and they will listen.' For 2 whole years, Paul stayed there in his own rented house and welcomed all who came to see him. He proclaimed the kingdom of God and taught about the Lord Jesus Christ with all boldness and without hindrance." I'll pray now for John as he comes to share the message of God's word. Lord God, we thank you that we have your word. We thank you that it is living and active. We thank you that it permeates our hearts and our souls. And we pray now for John as he brings this message, Lord. We pray that your spirit will work through him to teach us, to speak to us, to encourage us, Lord. We pray that you will be transforming us through the power of your word. Amen.
Thanks, Ellie. That was a difficult moment handing over those chocolates. Great. So we're going through the Bible in 2 years, and we've been going through Acts, and today we just read the final chapter in Acts. And we're going to look now at the whole book in one go. And the whole book is really a sequel to Luke, written by the same person, and it's got lots of the same themes. And you know, there are some sequels that are not really planned. They've written the first book, or let's be honest, the first film, and it's gone really well, and so they've made loads of money, and they're like, okay, let's do another one. Let's make more money. Acts is not like that. It is together with Luke. They basically form one whole united message. And Luke is about what God did through Jesus while Jesus was here on earth. And Acts is about what God did through Jesus after Jesus had gone up to heaven. And Luke, pretty early on, makes it clear that at the center of Jesus' work is a message. Jesus gives a manifesto early on in his ministry in Luke. And he says, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me. He's anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor, freedom for captives, sight to people who are blind." And he does that. His ministry is going around setting people free from evil, healing people. It's good news to the poor. And right at the end of his ministry in Luke, Jesus clarifies what this means in the light of his death and resurrection. He says, it was written that the Messiah had to suffer and rise again from the dead, and that repentance and the forgiveness of sins will be proclaimed in his name to all nations. And he said, you are going to be clothed, he said to his disciples, you're going to be clothed with power from on high. So he has this message of freedom, of liberty, of sight, of wealth. And at the end of his life, he makes it clear that weirdly, that is going to come to pass through his death and resurrection. And in the first manifesto, right at the start of his ministry in Luke, he says, the Spirit of the Lord is on me. And at the end of Luke, he says, wait, and the Holy Spirit will come on you. So this message of hope, of freedom, of this kind of topsy-turvy delivery through death and resurrection, and the Holy Spirit empowering. And what we're going to see is, basically, Acts has the same message and the same Holy Spirit. And Acts is about a journey, the journey of this message and this Spirit. In chapter 1 of Acts, Jesus says, wait for this power. And he says, you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, which is a city. There you can see it. And in Samaria and Judea, and that's a kind of a region. You can see that's the little red circle. And then beyond that, to the ends of the earth. And that's kind of the structure of Acts. Jerusalem, the mission to Jerusalem is covered in chapters 1 to 7. The kind of the journey through Judea and Samaria in chapters 8 to 12, and the ends of the earth from chapters 13 to 28. So there's this kind of dynamism. It's the same Spirit, it's the same message, but it's on a journey, it's going places, and it crosses barriers, it breaks chains, it sets people free, and it's still moving today. Acts has quite an abrupt end in a way, and I think that's deliberate. It's because it's still happening. So, Jerusalem first, and that's chapters 1 to 7. And in chapter 1, you start with 120 disciples who are hiding. They're hiding in this little room, and they're terrified. Their leader's just been killed. But by the time you get to the end of chapter 7, you have a massive group that has transformed Jerusalem, that's living this kind of exciting community life that's beautiful and attractive that people want to join, and is being attacked, is being persecuted. And in spite of that persecution, it is thriving, it's confident. And that starts with Pentecost. So Jesus told them to wait, so they're waiting. And he says, wait until you're baptized by the Holy Spirit. Now, baptism is when you plunge something into water, plunge a person into water. And so Jesus is saying, wait, because you are going to be plunged into the Holy Spirit. You're going to be drenched, if you like, in the Holy Spirit. So they're waiting in this upper room. And there's this sound like the rushing of wind. There's fire. And these people who are terrified are filled with boldness. And they can speak, suddenly, languages that they haven't learned. And so the people around are like, what's going on? Are you guys drunk? We don't really understand this. And Peter responds and he says, no, we're not drunk. This is what was promised. The Holy Spirit is here. It's causing these crazy things to happen. We are witnesses of Jesus Christ. He's this man who did these crazy miracles. He was sent by God. And you, according to God's plan, according to God's desire, killed him. You killed him. But he was raised from the dead, and Peter stands up and says, we are witnesses that Jesus Christ rose from the dead. And so everyone's like, what do we do? And Peter says, repent and be baptized for the forgiveness of sins. And repentance just means turning around. He's saying, turn away from the wrong in your lives and turn to Jesus Christ. And so they do that, and loads of them repent and are baptized. And they're not just baptized individuals. They enter this community, and there's this lovely description in Acts 2 of this community of disciples. They're transformed. They're teaching, they're sharing, they're living together, they're eating together, they're praying together. And what we have here is the same Spirit that Jesus had, authenticating the same message that Jesus delivered. And what it's bringing is change. Then there's healing. Peter and John are walking past the temple, and there's a guy who's lame there, and he's been there his whole life. So Jesus would have walked past him loads of times. But Jesus never healed him. This healing was saved until this moment, if you like. Peter and John, they say, look at us. And then this guy looks at them, he's expecting money, and they say, I don't have gold and silver, but in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, get up and walk. And this guy gets up, and there's this massive crowd. They run to there. And Peter, again, he takes the opportunity to speak this message. He says, you guys, you killed the author of life. You killed Jesus. But God raised him from the dead. We are witnesses of this. So repent, turn, believe. And people did. There was change in people's lives. And what happened then is the authorities start to get worried about what's going on because they were kind of involved in the crucifixion of Jesus. They made it happen. So they say, look, stop preaching this guy's name. Or we're gonna do really bad things to you. But they go out in the streets and they just carry on. They don't care. And you get the same cycle. There's more healings, there's more preaching, and there's more persecution. Again, they're threatened. And again, they're released. And eventually, there's the guy, Stephen, and at this point, the disciples, they're sharing in all sorts of crazy ways. People are selling their possessions and giving to one another. And Stephen, he stands up and he argues with people about who Jesus was. He kind of makes the case, Jesus is the Messiah. You need to repent and believe. And the authorities, they put him on trial. And in his kind of speech, his defense, they get so angry that they, at a certain point in the trial, they just rush at him, they cover their ears, and they drag him outside and they stone him. And at that point, there's a shift. Because up until this point, they've kind of been applying pressure on the leaders, but now the authorities in Jerusalem just decide, we have to destroy this movement. So they attack it. A guy called Saul, who becomes a key figure, spoiler alert, he takes into his head to destroy the church. He goes around putting people in prison. So what's going on here? Well, it's the same Holy Spirit. These healings are happening because the Spirit that was in Jesus is in these people. And the message is the same message that Jesus finished with. Death, resurrection, repentance, belief, and life. Life to the full. And at the end of this point, we have a church that is really having pressure applied to it, where people are being arrested, where people are being threatened. Their life is at risk. And it's weirdly through this that the next stage happens. It's through the persecution. Because what happens, this persecution, this pressure, this fear actually flings the gospel out. Pushes it beyond its natural barriers into Judea and Samaria. And that happens in chapter 8. So, at the start of chapter 8, you have all the people who are Christians, all the people who've heard this message of Jesus are Jewish people, and they're living around Jerusalem. You know, some Jewish people have traveled from distant lands and have then maybe gone home, but basically it's a Jerusalem thing, and it's definitely a Jewish thing. By chapter 12, it's broken through all sorts of barriers. It's traveled to Samaria and Judea. It's traveled to Africa. And it's traveled to Gentile people. And that might not seem like a big deal to us, but back in the day, that was huge. Gentile people becoming Christians was just unimaginable. And Philip is the first person who did this. He's kind of in chapter 8. He goes to Samaria with the same Holy Spirit and the same message. And he proclaims the Messiah. People believe and are baptized. And then there's questions, is this legit? People from Jerusalem check it out. It is. The Holy Spirit comes down and they're baptized. He goes to Samaria. And then Philip, he is sent to the desert in the middle of nowhere and he encounters this Ethiopian official, a very powerful man in Ethiopia. And Philip, again, preaches the same message, and the same Holy Spirit comes on him, and a barrier is crossed. Samaritans are now Christian, and now this African guy's Christian. It crosses into Africa. And then, Saul at this point. So Saul, last time we saw him, he is trying to destroy the whole Christian church. And now, the Christian church has been scattered by the persecution. And Saul, he wants to destroy it, so he follows it out. So he goes to where the Christians are, in a place called Damascus, and he goes with authority to make life really difficult to them, to arrest them, to beat them, to torture them. But on the way, God encounters him in a powerful, powerful way. And it's Ananias who comes to him and gives him the same message. And the same Holy Spirit falls on Paul. and a barrier is crossed again. Paul is the most surprising person. Sorry, I'm calling him Saul and Paul because he changes his name. So I'm going to call him Paul from now on, but he's also Saul. Again, a barrier is crossed. That's what's going on here. The most unlikely person, the persecutor, is now a disciple. The unexpected can be initiated. And the next barrier that gets crossed is the biggest one. So Gentiles and Jews did not get on at this point in time. And that was partly because the Jews had very strict laws. They had purity laws about what they could eat, and they weren't really allowed to mix with Gentiles at all. They certainly couldn't eat with them. And Peter is a devout Jew, and all the people who had become Christians were Jews. And Peter, he's hungry at home. We've all been there. And do you know when you're really hungry, you're so hungry, you kind of fall into a faint and have a little hunger dream. Peter does that. And in his hunger dream, loads of animals that he's not allowed to eat are presented to him to eat. And he's like, no, I'm not going to eat them. But a voice says, eat these animals. And that happens three times. And then when he wakes up from that, he has a voice saying, some people are going to come. You've got to follow them. But the people who come are Gentiles. They're the people he's not allowed to associate with. And we haven't got time to explore just how big a barrier this was to cross. But for Jewish people to eat unclean food was unimaginable. For Jewish people to eat with Gentiles or to think they were on a par with Gentiles was unimaginable. But this same message, this same spirit crosses that boundary. It drags Peter across the threshold. And Peter is confronted with the reality that he has to go to these people who he does not like, who he doesn't think the gospel is for, and he goes, and he proclaims, and he says, I didn't expect this, but here I am, basically. Jesus Christ, I saw, he did these miracles, and he died, he was killed, he was crucified, he was nailed to the tree, and he rose from the dead. I'm a witness to this, and so repent. Turn and believe. And they do. It's the same message, and the Spirit falls on them in power. It's really obvious what's happened, and they're baptized. Barrier is crossed. It's this kind of middle bit. Judea and Samaria, somehow Gentiles are included in this message. And then this section finishes with a kind of a passing of the baton. So chapter 12 is kind of like a farewell to Peter. Peter's been, like, in some ways, the main character of chapters 1 to 7. You could almost say it's the Acts of Peter, the apostle. He's been doing most of the big speaking. He's been doing loads of the miracles. And in chapter 12, we kind of have a bit of a goodbye. He is arrested, and then he gets released. It's all very exciting. But what that does is it shifts from Peter, who was focused on reaching the Jews, and then is suddenly had his mind blown that the Gentiles are included. And it's a shift to Paul, whose whole life work is reaching Gentiles, taking this message to the ends of the earth. And he does this in various missionary journeys. So that's the way this bit is structured. Three missionary journeys and also a little council. So the first missionary journey, you can see, it's kind of in what we call modern-day Turkey. And what he does, he goes around and he proclaims the word of God. So he goes to Cyprus, proclaims the word, people believe. There are miracles, there's opposition, but it's overcome. The next place he goes to, Pisidian Antioch. Jesus, again, is invited to speak to a Jewish crowd. And what he does is he does the same, preaches the same message, surprisingly enough. He says, Jesus Christ was promised by the scriptures, but he was killed, buried in the tomb. He rose again. And again, repent and believe. And by now, you should be getting used to this. It's the same message, isn't it? And it's the same spirit. And what we're going to see is the opposition that happened before happens here as well. He goes to a place called Iconium. Again, proclaims there's opposition. Lystra, he proclaims there's miracles, and the people think that he's God. They try and worship him, and he says, no, don't worship me. Worship the true and living God. And then he travels back, he goes to Derby, then travels back through those places again. Can you see what's happened is you have outward momentum. It's dynamic. It's moving from place to place, this message. And it's the same message. It's the same spirit, and it's crossing barriers. Once Paul gets back from that journey with his team, there's a council in Jerusalem. Basically, lots of people who are Jewish believers are not happy about the Gentile believers becoming Christians and not living like Jews. They think that everyone should be following Jewish purity laws and, you know, getting circumcised, things like that. And so there's this big kind of debate. And the decisive moment is when Peter and Barnabas and Paul, they get up and they say, we have seen this. We are witnesses of what God is doing. Something powerful is happening here. And they say, this message, this gospel news is not about what we do. It's not about following rules. It's about grace. It's about freely receiving what God has done in Jesus Christ. And so the decision is made, this momentous decision, is not to kind of pull back from crossing barriers, to withdraw, but actually to celebrate that this is going out and to go further, to cross more and more barriers, to go out, to be sent, because this message is on the move. So they go on their second missionary journey. Paul goes through Philippi, where people become saved. And again, that's a massive barrier being crossed. You can kind of lose it, but there's a moment on this red line where it goes from Turkey into Macedonia or Greece. That moment is the moment that the barrier is crossed of the gospel reaching Europe. Big news. Exciting moments. And it happens because Paul is actually trying to do his thing in Turkey, what we call now Turkey. Then they called it Asia Minor. But he has a vision. He can't do it, first of all. He's trying to do his thing in Turkey. It's not working. The Spirit's kind of stopping him somehow. And then he's not a hunger trance this time. He's just asleep. But he has a vision. And in it, a guy from Macedonia says, come and help us. Tell us this news. So it's a direct intervention. And he goes into Europe. And in Philippi, people are saved. It's the same spirit, it's the same message. And there's one little girl who's oppressed by this spirit, which is leading her to do all sorts of like dark things. And Paul casts this spirit out. And there's a massive response to that. A mob takes them, they get arrested, they get put in prison. And they get rescued from prison by this big earthquake. And this jailer who comes in and is like, oh no, my people have all escaped. But they say, don't worry, we're still here. And he says, why are you still here? And it provokes some kind of existential crisis in him. And he says, what do I need to do to be saved? And they say, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you'll be saved. He believes, he's baptized. Again, it's the same message. Believe in Jesus. Be changed. They move on from Philippi. They go through Thessalonica, they proclaim the gospel there, and there's riots. They go to Berea, again, there's riots there, and then they go to Athens. And in Athens, they're invited to speak. And Paul gets up and he speaks and he says, guys, I can see you really like worshipping gods. Good on you. I'm going to tell you about a God that you don't know about, the one true God who made heaven and earth. And he made you. And he is going to come. He's overlooked your ignorance before, but he's going to come and he's going to demand an account of you. He's going to come to judge you. And the proof of that is that Jesus Christ was raised from the dead. And that message, packaged slightly differently, is the same one. And it landed, not with everyone. Again, there was some opposition. From Athens, he went to Ephesus and Corinth. There was a riot in Ephesus, surprise, surprise, a riot in Corinth. Everywhere there's riots. And then eventually they return to their base in Antioch. And the third mission of Paul is a bit of a, if we see, it's basically the same itinerary. And we don't have as much information about it. Paul goes to lots of the same places. We presume he's doing the same things. We presume there are riots because there always are. That's the way Paul operates. And it's interesting. There's the same message. There's the same spirit. Barriers are being crossed. There is opposition. It's a repeated process over and over again. And the gospel is on the move. It's going to the ends of the earth. Finally, Paul is in Jerusalem and on his way to Jerusalem, lots of people are saying, Paul, if you go to Jerusalem, you're going to be all sorts of trouble. Because everywhere you go, Jewish people want to kill you. And Jerusalem is like the place where all the Jewish people are. So please don't go there. But he goes there. And he goes there knowing that it's dangerous. And it is. He gets seen. He gets beaten to nearly an inch of his life. And he takes the opportunity, nutter that he is, to speak to all this mob that's tried to kill him. And he says, Jesus Christ has changed my life. And he goes through what happened in his life. He goes through the transforming power of Jesus. And when he gets to the point where he says, then I went to speak to the Gentiles, they all kick off. And Paul goes through different places, different trials, basically, in front of the Jewish Sanhedrin, their kind of Jewish trial. He again says, I'm here because of the resurrection hope. In front of three Roman rulers, he says, he uses it as an opportunity to tell his story about what Jesus has done for him and to say, I'm here because of the resurrection hope, because Jesus died and rose again, and he is a light for my people and a light for the Gentiles. And finally, we get to the chapter that we were in, Acts 28. And he is taken to Rome in chains, but the gospel word is not chained. Day after day, people are coming into his little home, kind of like home slash prison, and he's telling them this story. So, in terms of the structure of Acts as a whole, you've got Jerusalem, you've got Judea and Samaria, you've got the ends of the earth. It's kind of... And it's the same message that you get in Luke the whole way through. Hope, life, freedom, sight, the Holy Spirit. And it's the same Spirit that empowered Jesus' ministry that is evident throughout Acts. And that Spirit is taking this place. It's crossing barriers. It's going to new places, encountering new people and changing in surprising ways, in ways that no one is expecting, in ways that frankly make people uncomfortable. Because the kind of people who are coming in are not the kind of people that they feel are their people. It's not a comfortable book because there's so much life in it. So what does this mean for us? Well, we have the same message. Jesus Christ, attested by God with miracles. He was a man. He came to earth and he did incredible things. He preached life and light and he brought life and light to people. He healed people. He died, not by some kind of accident, but because that was God's plan to redeem the world. And he rose again after 3 days. And in Acts, we are told again and again that this was not a random thing. It was for the forgiveness of sins. By some way, when we believe in Jesus, when we see his death and his resurrection, there is forgiveness. There is hope. And again in Acts, we see Peter, we see Paul, we see Philip, we see all these people standing up and saying, we are witnesses of this. We have heard this, we have seen it. We have seen Jesus Christ change lives, and that is what we are this morning. We are a group of people who have witnessed Jesus Christ changing lives. We have seen the power of the death and resurrection of Jesus. We've seen it in our own lives, and we've seen it in the lives of each other. Could speak about my own experience. I stand here today as a witness of the power of Jesus Christ. I was a self-righteous, bullying arsonist. I was insufferable. And Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection has changed me. In him, there is hope, there is life. The death and resurrection of Jesus is not a pretty little fairy story. It has power, spiritual power. And I've seen people in this room experience healing, spiritual and physical. I've seen addictions dealt with. I've seen people restored, people recovered. I've seen life in dark places. Because of Jesus Christ, because of his death, because of his resurrection, we this morning are witnesses of that. And the call of this is repent and believe. Turn away from the wrong in your life and turn to Jesus Christ. That is the message. And it's not just a message that we have, it's the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit of Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit that powers, that drives acts. That is the Holy Spirit that we have. He is ours. Not because of anything we've done, but because of the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that Spirit gives them boldness, it gives them courage, and it gives them power in surprising ways. Not power through dominating people or getting control, but power through liberating people. Power through, in the midst of, despite suffering, despite persecution, despite being outsiders, despite being despised and rejected. The Holy Spirit gives us courage to speak, not to persuade and win arguments, but to say, I have seen this. I have seen the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ changing other people's lives and my life. The same Spirit authenticates the same message. And this happens in different ways. Sometimes the Holy Spirit speaks and it's a thunder. The gospel message, the gospel reality hits like a ton of bricks, like a train smashing off the rails, I don't know. But sometimes it's a still small voice. Sometimes the Holy Spirit will speak in a very discernible, powerful way, and sometimes it will just be a sense of peace. But what happens in Acts over and over again is the Spirit authenticates the gospel message. It lands. And all who call on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ will be saved. And all who are saved are sent. If you have heard this call and you have repented and responded, then you are sent. We're gathered here today as a group. But most of our time, most of the week, we're not here together, are we? We're scattered. We're sent. But it's easy not to be sent internally in our own psychology. It's easy just to go out of here and have the rest of our week, right? To turn up to work or school or uni, whatever. Go home. But we are sent. This same dynamism, this same energy, this same drive, that is still ours. The same Holy Spirit, the same message. And that's about crossing barriers, going in surprising places, surprising you. Peter was not expecting to be dragged by the scruff of his neck into Gentile territory, but it's where the Holy Spirit took him. And the Holy Spirit gave him everything he needed for it, gave him the courage, gave him the message. And we're sent as witnesses the power and hope of the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And that changes everything. And so, this should be visible where we are. Now, what does that mean? What does it mean for this to be visible? It means being honest, basically, and open. It doesn't mean pretending. It means being who we are. People who have heard this, who have seen things, who have changed. It's not a big deal. Sometimes it feels like a big deal. Sometimes it feels really scary. And sometimes it will lead us into situations where we're not comfortable. I mean, hello, act. But the call is to be who we are, to talk about who we know, to be open that Jesus Christ is good news, that his death and resurrection has changed us and has the power to change other people. And so often in my life, I make a decision for other people. I say, oh, you're not a likely person. You're a bit like Paul, you know, persecuting Christians, or you're too far away, your culture and you're a bit Gentile for me. I'll be very kind, I'll be very generous, I'll be very... But I won't say, Jesus Christ died and rose again, and there is life in that. And it doesn't need to be, this is the gospel in four steps, well, that's great, but actually just, this is who I am. I'm just a person who has been saved, and I'm different now. Witness. And there's something exciting about this, right? The crossing of barriers. The breaking of chains. The opening of eyes. Freedom. Life. It's for us as we're scattered, but it's also for us as we're gathered. We really want people to hear this news. We really want to reach people with this, because it is good news. And so as a church, we've been, as a leadership, the elders, we've been talking about church planting. We're looking for opportunities to plant, to establish other congregations, because in a small congregation, it's easier to invite people sometimes, because it's easier to get stuck in. We don't want it to grow and have a big periphery of people who like coming but aren't really kind of growing and discipling others. In Acts, we see over and over people are planting churches. So we're looking for opportunities, and we're also praying for leaders. And I don't mean leaders with a capital L. I mean leaders with a small L. I mean servants. I mean people who are godly, people who love the Lord Jesus Christ, who know him, who disciple other people, who speak about what they've experienced and who grow over time in small ways, in big ways, becoming more like Jesus, showing the fruit of the Spirit. So an encouragement to step up for each of us, really, to look out for people and disciple them. Which just means getting to know them and talking about Jesus with them, really, and seeking to grow and trying to help them grow. We want that. And it makes me so happy when I see that happening, when I see just people loving each other in a way that leads to spiritual growth. As we finish, we're gathered here this morning because the gospel of Jesus Christ, this good news, this death and resurrection stuff, has landed by the power of the Spirit in our lives. Sometimes, many times, sometimes, just the once. And if it's landed for the first time for you this morning, I'd really encourage you to respond. And the way you do that is by talking to God about this. I've talked a bit about repentance, and repentance is just turning away from the wrong in our lives and turning towards Jesus, the one who died, the one who rose. So I'm going to pray a prayer now, and I'd encourage you to just pray it with me in your head. Whether that's the first time or you've prayed it before, but I don't want to finish without offering that opportunity. Father God, thank you that Jesus Christ died and rose again. I turn away from the wrong in my life, and I turn towards Jesus Christ. Father, send me, I pray. Amen. And if you're here, and it's landed before, if it's taken root, and if it's who you are, then remember that you're sent. It's the same message. And it's the same Holy Spirit. This doesn't have to be history books. Acts finishes quite abruptly. It's quite a weird ending in some ways. And I think that's because it's carried on. And sometimes in the West, because we've come from a place where there was a big Christian heritage, we lose sight of the fact that globally, Christianity is growing massively across the world. This spread is still happening. So let's be part of it.
we're going to respond to that now in song and in prayer. There'll be a prayer team who will be out on the back seats. So if you'd like to pray about what we've been hearing or something that's going on in your life right now, whether it's big or small, you'd be really welcome to join the team in that. And we're going to sing together. I'm just going to read some words in Acts 13. It says, "We tell you the good news, what God has promised our ancestors, he has fulfilled for us, their children, by raising up Jesus." So we're going to be singing about God who keeps his promises and that nothing compares to that promise we have in Jesus. And that is transformative. As our next song says, that he is moving here. He's touching every heart, turning lives around. As John was saying, that movement just keeps going through the power of Jesus and his spirit in us. So let's respond and stand and sing now.
My God, that is who you are.
That is
miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. My Jesus,
God, we praise you that Jesus is the King, that he is mighty and powerful and is here working in this place. Lord God, we pray that we will just put our trust in that, that will empower us, embolden us to be sent, to take action, Lord, to share the good news, that incomparable promise that we have in you, Lord. Amen. Do please take your seats. That brings us to the end of our time together this morning. Thank you so much for joining us here together. It's great to gather as one people, as a family. As we finish, I'll read from Acts 1. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Amen.